thank you. And I thank the organizers for, of course, inviting me. And also for when the invitation arrived. The invitation arrived about 5 days ago. And so I had already planned to come here because I was in Heidelberg about 30, 40 years ago, working at EMBL for about a month. And so I was pleased to see Heidelberg again. But then all of a sudden, Alex Pop called me, and I was not prepared. I thought he wanted me to simply read the lecture of Bob Young, who was not able to come. And on the phone, I didn't understand, and I said, oh, yes, I will do it. But then I also asked him to send me a message so that I could really understand what he wanted from me. And so I was quite surprised that I was supposed to come and give a lecture by myself. So this explains why I was not able to prepare the lecture. And but that's the Italian style, perhaps. I can try to make it anyway. And the first thing is that I will not have any slide to show, so you will rely only on what I will be able to tell you. And before getting to the topic of my talk, I think I will mention a few projects which I would label just classical science. First of all, I'm a neurobiologist, and neurobiologists, they should all be involved in the relationship between brain and mind. But most of them, I think, are just reductionists. So they keep working on brain, and many of them believe that brain or mind are exactly the same thing. And perhaps I'm unusual because I think mind is much more different than brain, although brain is fantastically complex and interesting. But there is something which is more interesting and more fantastic than brain. So in Heidelberg, what I was trying to do, I will be quite brief, but I hope that you will understand what project I was working on at that time. I came here because there was a Swedish investigator who had a very nice method for measuring the amount of DNA in single cells. The Swedish school was famous at that time. We are talking about 30 or perhaps more years ago. To measure the picograms amount of RNA and also DNA in single cells. So my project regarded octopus as cephalopod that you can find in Naples, and as a strange, very intelligent animal, and has some lobes, some of which have perfect deployed amount, what is called deployed amount of DNA, but some others, by measuring with colorimetric method, they seem to have much higher amount, and that increase would be in parallel with the increase in body weight of the octopus. So a result of experience, I would say, of octopus. So that was of great interest to me, especially because I was working with rat on another aspect of brain DNA, and that was the metabolic, so-called metabolic DNA. At that time, of course, DNA was, we are talking about perhaps 40 years ago, or 30, 40. And so DNA was supposed to be like God. It was only expressing, giving information to the rest of the cell, but it would not participate directly, metabolically. It was only be synthesized when the cell would divide, and the other possibility that it would be synthesized in fragments for repair. Whenever there was a damage, then it would repair it, and so that it would regain its original structure. But we alerted by another fellow called Pelk that there could be a fraction of DNA which was metabolic, was continuously synthesized and degraded together with the functions of the cell. So we followed this in the rat. And in the rat, we found that, first of all, in the rat brain, that we found a lot of synthesis of, by providing radiolabeled precursors, we found a lot of synthesis of DNA in the brain, which lasted only for a few hours and then started to decrease. Well, to make a long story short, what we found that there were at least a dozen physiological conditions, including different types of learning and also the sleep that follows learning, in which there is a processing of memories. And under these conditions, we found that the synthesis of DNA during learning, for instance, was modified in brain in different ways in different regions of the brain. And the other thing which is also, I think, is striking is that, and I will tell you, because my second project was about sleep and the function of sleep with regard to processing of memories. The other striking thing with newly synthesized DNA, that after a complex training in rats is allowed to sleep, then the amount of newly synthesized DNA in brain decreases about 50%, but only in rats which have not been able to learn the task. So that they include also the capacity. So it's a correlate of learning. It remains in the rats which have learned the task, and this appears at least 50% in those which have not learned the task. So this explains why I was so interested in the apparent amount of DNA in some octopus brain lobes. So this I could continue this, but otherwise I will never get to the position. The other interesting, at least for me, interesting project, in a way related to DNA, I would call it local gene expression. What I mean is that, as you know, the brain are just normal cells, but they are special in the sense that they have to reach far away region of the bodies. Normal cells are only nucleus surrounded by some cytoplasm and only like a sphere, or they might have all sorts of geometry, but they certainly do not have long process, which may be meters long. And then at the end, you have terminals. Now, the dogma at that time was that whatever was in the, this process is called axon. It can be long, meters long. Whatever you find in the axon, especially proteins, is supposed to be coming from the cell body, because the cell body was supposed to be the only factory for proteins. So after they were made, they could be traveled and reach the faraway distance of the nerve cells. Well, this created a lot of theoretical problem, because traveling would take long time. So for instance, there is a so-called slow flow, which is only 1 millimeter per day. So if you have an axon about a meter long, you need 365 days before whatever you prepare in the cell body would reach the periphery. And again, to make a long story short, we started working at the possibility that the dogma was not true, that not all proteins were synthesized in the cell body, but there was a capacity to synthesize protein also in the axon and also in the nerve terminals. And to do that, we chose a very advantageous preparation from the squid. So I went for, I don't know, perhaps 30 years, 30 summers at the marine station in Woodsall in the United States to work on squid. And the squid, the special feature of the squid, there is a so-called giant axon. While our axons are very thin, they are about 10 micrometers in diameter, the largest. The squid has this giant axon, which is about half a millimeter. So you can actually look at it, and you can see by naked eye. And so when it was discovered, people thought it was just a vessel, couldn't be an axon. But really, it is an axon. So what you can do with this giant axon, you can simply squeeze it and obtain the axoplasm, the interior, and therefore it makes life very easy to see what happens inside the axon. And so that's what we did. You can simply incubate the axon with the radiolabeled amino acids that are the precursors of proteins, and you squeeze the axon at the end, and you find radiolabeled protein inside the axoplasm. So that shows, and of course you use specific inhibitors and so on and so forth. So you can, that was a simple way in which we could prove, and of course there are many more experiments, but we could prove that there was a local synthesis of protein. And a similar approach could be done with the nerve terminals. Again, the squid has a special optic lobes, which are close to the eye, and they receive the photo from there's photoreceptor cells, which are in the retina, and whenever they get inside the optic lobe, they form very large terminals. Our terminals are about 1 micrometer in diameter or less, and these terminals in the squid are about 4 to 5 micrometers. So they are, again, they are very large, and so it's much easier to find out what happens in the nerve terminals. So nerve terminals in rat and also in the squid, they can be prepared relatively easy by homogenizing the brain, because during homogenization, the terminals detach and the membrane fuse, so they make little sacs which you can separate, and then you can work with them. But in the rat, they are mixed with all sorts of other material, while in the squid, it's very easy because these large terminals are unique in the. So what you can do is you prepare this synaptosome, add the precursor, and again find that inside the terminals you have a lot of radiolabeled proteins, and so you can show that. Not only the axon, but also the terminals are capable. They have an active system of synthesis for proteins. They may be about 200 different proteins they can be made in the axon or in the nerve terminals. So that was the other project, but only part of it. Because as soon as you find that in these peripheral regions, you have the capacity to synthesize proteins, then since the machinery required to make these proteins is an RNA machinery, of course the question is, where does the RNA come from? And of course the conventional answer is that it comes from the cell body. But again, you have the same problem of length and therefore time required to reach the periphery and so on and so forth. And so we came out with an additional hypothesis that these RNA were made in the periphery, but not in the axon or in the nerve terminals, because they do not have the DNA needed to make the RNA, because you need a template DNA to make the RNA. Simply, you know, most people when think of or talk of brain, think only of the neurons, like the neurons were the only cells present in the brain. And that's not true. I think the neurons are only a small fraction. Some people think about 10%, some other people even less. The other cells are called glia cells. The glia means glue. So initially they were thought of being simply the glue that kept the neurons together. Well, but these glia cells are just normal cells. So, and they surround any aspect of the neuron, including the axon and including the nerve terminals. You almost never find an axon naked without glia cells. So the idea was that the glia cells could synthesize those RNA and then transfer them to the axon and transfer them to the cell body, to the nerve terminals. And so we could prove this, again, using the giant axon, because in the giant axon is so large that you can even perfuse it internally. You can put a cannula inside, on one side and then the other, and then you perfuse it, and you can collect the perfusate every 5 minutes, every 10 minutes, so you have a dynamic view of what happens. So if you incubate the giant axon, perfused giant axon, with a radiolabeled uridine, which is a precursor of RNA, and then you collect the perfusate from the axon, then you find radiolabeled RNA. After 1 minute, you start seeing radiolabeled RNA in the perfusate, which is made by the glia cell, and then transferred to the axon, and then taken by the flow of the perfusate, and you can collect it, and so on. And the reason that we demonstrated that this came from the glia cell, because the whole process could be modulated by the receptors which are present exclusively in the glia cell surrounding the axon. Other people had found out by electrophysiology that these glia cells they have a potential, a resting potential, which can be modulated. And so by using the right agonist of these receptors, we could increase the amount of RNA, of RNA found in the perfusate. And since these receptors are only in the glia around the axon, of course, that RNA could come only from the glia. And so that our second project, at least in outline, I hope I was not too bad in describing it, that you could easily understand what I meant. The third project, which becomes closer to my theoretical thoughts that come later, is sleep. Sleep, is composed at least of two different types of EEG, especially EEG characterized component. One is what I would say the real sleep, because I call it real because the EEG is completely different from waking. In waking, you have a lot of high frequency, low intensity activity, while during so-called slow wave sleep, then the frequency decreases quite a bit. From about 20 or 30 hertz, you can get down to 4, 2, 3 hertz. So it's very different. And the other type of sleep is called paradoxical sleep. And the name comes from the fact that during sleep, while man or the animal is quite asleep, all of a sudden the EEG pattern of the brain becomes like it's awake. So the starts going to be high frequency, low intensity, low amplitude waves. And since the most dreams, especially the most complex dreams, come during paradoxical sleep, most people thought that this was the only interest in life, there was only paradoxical sleep. And so when people started to observe that you have processing of memories, not only during waking, but especially for the complex tasks, especially complex for the rat, for instance, which are, of course, obvious for men, but for the rat is very complex, then you need processing that happens during sleep. And so people started to say the only type of sleep which is involved in memory processing is paradoxical sleep. And to me, this did not make sense, because before the episodes of paradoxical sleep, you start sleeping with slow wave sleep. And slow wave sleep is about 80% of the sleep. Paradoxical sleep is only 20%. So I consider sleep a unitary and also related to waking. And so I proposed that also slow wave sleep was involved in learning. And so under conditions in which we expose rats to complex tasks, we could observe that there was an increase in the episodes, in the number of episodes of paradoxical sleep, which was already known. But before that, there was a variation in the length of the slow wave episodes, which became longer. And that was the difference with the, between paradoxical and slow wave sleep. And so we could demonstrate that slow wave sleep was also involved. And our further hypothesis is that what happens during slow wave sleep is that the rat, the brain, gets rid of information which has acquired during wakefulness, which is not essential. And there is plenty of information which every moment gets into the brain. So you have to get rid of whatever you don't want to save, but simply save the essential. So there is a cleaning that slow wave operates on memories, acquired memories. And after the cleaning, then memories can be put back again in better position and so better retrieved from brain whenever you're awake, because the whole operation, of course, requires that you not only have memories, but you know how to retrieve them in the right time and under the right conditions. So that's very essential. It's not only memory remaining, but you have to know where to look and how to get them. So hypothesis is we call a sequential hypothesis. In other words, you don't have only one type of processing during paradoxical sleep, but you have two steps. The first step is during slow wave sleep, and then you go to paradoxical sleep, and then you finally go back to wake, having learned whatever you were exposed to during the previous. So this was a sequential hypothesis and a kind of spiral, because if you think of day after day, of course you go from waking to sleep, the two types of sleep, and then to wake again with more information than before, and so on and so forth. So this was the third project, which I meant to remember. But I also want to mention that I do not consider myself, a classical scientist in the strict sense, in the sense I realize that classical science, not quantum, I won't worry about quantum physics, but classical science has a lot of limits and that I don't want to mention here. And most scientists, especially biologists, they like to keep those limits and not challenge them. And I think if one is a researcher, he should challenge those limits and try to go beyond it. And so one thing that first I need to mention is that I've been teaching physiology. I'm a neurobiologist, so I teach neurobiology, but also general physiology. And physiology deals with biological functions. And at the very beginning of my teaching, I just looked at books to see whether there was a definition of biological function, and I couldn't find it in any book. And so I started to think myself what it could be. But if you think of biological functions, of course, you have to go a different level of organization. It's not only, the action potential in nerves, but you have to go down to molecules, to cells, and then to molecules. And then below molecules, you have atoms and you have elementary particles. And then if you go the other side, then the organism, and especially man, has families, has society, has ecosystems and whatever. Nobody really knows what's at the end of either end. And so to make a definition is hard, because you go from very small and very fast and very short to very long and very distant and so on. But anyway, the sort of, usual property of a function, of a biological function, which I was able to find, is that first of all, they are cyclic. In other words, if you think, for instance, breathing or the heartbeat, cycling means that you go through an on phase and that is followed by an off phase. And of course, the off phase is not less important than the on phase, because without the off phase, you cannot have another on phase. If you remain at the on phase, you stop, the heart stops. So these, both of them are important, and but they are cyclic. And of course, there are some functions which repeat themselves while the organism remains alive. But at the same time, inside the organism, you have cells and you have molecules which have a very high turnover. Therefore, they are synthesized, and then they are degraded. They disappear, and they still replaced, continuously replaced. And this also regards cells. For instance, I was very impressed by the fact that teaching digestion, you have the epithelium of the intestinal tract, which simply defoliates. There are a lot of grams, several grams of cells just come out every day and die because they open up and free their own enzyme to help the digestion. So we live, our organism lives on the death of our components. And death is very fast for some molecules and also for cells which live only for a few days or perhaps a few months. So and then we ourselves, of course, we have this cycling because we are born and then we have to die at a certain time. So you look, this cycling is a wide common feature of all biological function. And I said that I could divide them in repetitive cycling, which are just do not imply death of the component which is cycling, but others in which the component dies and then it's replaced. So from this point of view, of course, the death of man, which of course I'm interested in myself and men, death of men is useful for people that come after you, for children, for instance, for the family. And it's also useful for society and for the civilization. And of course, you have death also of societies, death of civilization. And then, of course, you can start thinking why in terms of esoteric terms, let's say, why our death is important to what? And perhaps you can think that we are just like the cells of our intestine that die to help a bigger organism to survive and continue. But that's just a thought. Well, the other thing which is important about the function is that in every function, of course, there is an ordered movement of subcomponents that make up that function. And the other important concept that I want to mention is that in living entities, there are really no structure, but only functions. As soon as you see a structure by itself, that means that's dead. Perhaps if the organism die, then there are some functions which continue for a little time. Perhaps I know that a hair can continue for a while. But I mean, that is a function that continues. So structure is very useful to understand the function. But otherwise, what is living are just functions. And functions are sort of ephemeral things. They are not solid as structures. Structures are useful to understand what a function is. But in the living, again, I repeat, they are only function. So if you start from this point of view and you look at how all these organisms came about, of course, they came about of fertilized egg in a process which is called ontogeny. But the ontogeny, of course, was built on a much longer process, which took about 4 billion years, which is called phylogeny. So in talking in general, if you really want to know what biological feature, and when I say biological feature, usually is physical feature of organism, came from, you cannot stop to investigate the ontogeny of that organism. That is very important. But if you want to really know more, you have to go back all the way to the phylogeny, because phylogeny created the ontogeny. And ontogeny, of course, is run is controlled by information stored in the genome, but also information stored in the so-called epigenome, which is a much wider complex of proteins and RNA, which reads the genome. Without the epigenome, DNA information would be silent. Nobody would understand anything. And for instance, for men, we can distinguish, I think, about 200 different types of cell. The information in DNA is specific for each type of cell. So the epigenome of those cells reads only the information which is related to that type of cell. So the functional epigenome is just as important than the store of DNA. And the epigenome does not is not part of the genome. As the word says, is epigenome, above the genome. Now, so this brought me back to how is explained this phylogeny, what is the mechanism of this phylogeny? And of course, for more than a century, more than a century since we are already on the other century, the past century was completely dominated by neo-Darwinism. And neo-Darwinism, as the main tenets of the neo-Darwinism, are that variations which are required for multiplicity of the variety, tremendous variety of organisms, they come from variation. And these variations, according to neo-Darwinists, are chance events, mutation, they call them mutation, which must work on the genome of germ cells. Because neo-Darwinists have two main dogma. One dogma says that the germ cells are completely separated from the soma cells. The soma cells are, of course, about 99.9% of the whole organism. And they are completely separated from the germ cells. So there is no information flow that can go from soma to the germ cell, and therefore this cannot go to the progeny. This, I call it the cellular dogma. The other dogma, which came later on, it's molecular biology dogma, which says that information that once DNA was found and considered the depository of all biological information, DNA was only, the information from DNA, as I said before, was just like God, would go from DNA to RNA, and then from RNA to the protein. And then, of course, the hundreds or thousands of proteins in each cell would perform all the various functions of the cell. So there was a unilateral flow of information. And so since you need the information to be in DNA, this stopped any possibility that information we would get from the environment into the genome of organism, and not only the genome of the somatic cell, but only also must go to the germ cells to be useful for the progeny and be able to pass to the progeny whatever the experience of the parents have already done. So the whole situation is, according to neo-Darwinism, that organisms are able by themselves to adapt to the environment and to changes in the environment. But if they have a progeny, the progeny is not able to receive any information from the parents. The parents are completely useless from this point of view. And therefore, they just have to wait. And perhaps in the meantime, they would die, if depending on the change in the environment. They have to wait until random events happens with the right solution for that special problem. So if I can add that mutations are also neutral, most mutations are neutral, therefore they do not produce a real variation, and then most mutations are negative, they produce a bad change, not a progressive change, then overall, I think the whole story, and then of course to the story you have to add natural selection. And for natural selection, there would be another criticism that could be made. So I completely could not understand how all the real intelligence that I could see in the cells, in biology in general, and especially in the nervous system, the kind of fantastic structure which is created, they could have come from just random events. I wrote an article, we are talking back, this article in 82, long time ago, to propose a different mechanism, which is, let's say, that was the then present version of Lamarckian. So I would call it a neo-Lamarckian hypothesis. And you know that for Lamarck, organisms are able to adapt, but the information that they need, first of all, comes from the environment itself, because the information they store is just a complementary to, they have to oppose whatever variation, and therefore it's a complementary to the much more diverse information that is present in the environment. And he believed that this information was going to the germ cells and therefore to the progeny. This went to be called the inheritance of acquired characters. And now since the two dogma of neo-Darwinism, of course, neo-Lamarckian idea remain subterranean for about a century, but of course, I proposed a neo-Lamarckian view, therefore, that whatever change in the soma would be gone also to the germ cells and therefore to the progeny. But I can now state that in the literature, in the last few years, not many years, but there is at least 10, 20 papers which have already shown, definitely shown, that the inheritance of acquired characters do exist. But at least in those papers, there is no mention that there is a change in DNA. The change which they observe, they attribute to, is a change in the epigenome. So you have sort of a Lamarckian inheritance, but not by modifying DNA, simply by reading it in a different way. So that's the general idea. So I called my hypothesis that first of all would allow not only a cyclic flow of matter and energy between the organism and the environment. This is already quite well accepted. But because of the dogma, the neo-Darwinian dogma, of course, the flow of information is no longer cyclic. Because if you get information from the environment, it reaches your soma, but cannot reach your genome. And therefore, your progeny cannot have it. And so there is a stop. So that another reason why neo-Darwinism should be criticized. But in terms of what I believe that that was not true, then I called this mechanism so-called a spiral mechanism, just like I previously mentioned between waking and sleep. This was also kind of spiraling during everyday life. But in phylogeny was a spiraling, because whenever your organism becomes different from before, it works on the environment, it operates on the environment in a different way than before. And so the environment itself is also changed. And changing the environment, of course, means a change to which the organism has to adapt. And that would close not a circle, but a spiral, because this goes in time, and so it goes. The consequence of this thought is that not only the organism evolves, but also the environment. And this means a great responsibility for people who have consciousness, that they know things are this way, because you change the environment, but then you change yourself again, because the environment works back on you. And not only, it works back on every other species which is part of the ecosystem. If any organism changes the environment, the change in the environment is, of course, backlashed or reflected in all the other organisms. And they have to apply to adapt to this additional change of the environment. So this is why the reason I... And this sort of spiraling would explain, for instance, the presence of complexity in organisms. If you think at the very beginning, you have the elementary particles, and at the other end, you have man. So there is a tremendous increase in complexity. And this increase in complexity is present not in our own lineage, but in every lineage of phylogenesis. There is an increased complexity which cannot easily be explained by neo-Darwinism at all. But if you think of spiraling, then that's relatively easy to understand. So this one consequence, and I don't want to continue too much on this. And so I come to the last topic. I think I have a few more minutes. And as I said before, I think neurobiologists should the first one to be worried about the nature and the origin of mind. But most of them don't do it. But I try to think about this. And in the phylogeny, again, for mind is the same rule than for physical features of organism. You have to study ontogeny, but if you really want to understand, you have to study also phylogeny. And what is the phylogeny of mind? And this is the topic of this part of my talk. Now, I think for most, for the few people who have been interested in this topic, I think mind is mostly a man's feature. They probably are able to accept that perhaps primates, higher organisms, have a mind, and then they stop there. And I think there are considerations which make the start of mind much farther back than is currently thinking, and perhaps some people already know it. But I want to mention simply what was my kind of reasoning. My kind of reasoning was that if you accept simply the hypothesis, which I think is not true, but if you accept the idea that whenever there is mind, mental aspects are just strictly correlated to brain activity. So there is an equation, mind equals brain. Well, if you accept this, that would mean phylogenetically that whenever you find an organism with brain or with a nervous system, there could be also a mind, because there is no reason which prevents you from thinking this. We are not special. We are just grown out of phylogeny. So from this point of view, and of course, you cannot say that that organism has the same mind as we have. Just like even physical properties are different and primitive. So we have to adapt our way of thinking that there could be minds which are much more primitive than ourselves. And they started at the very beginning of nervous system from this consideration, okay? So simple consideration is, if you equate mind with brain, then whenever there is a brain or a nervous system, there must be a more primitive mind. I mean, relative to the complexity of the organism. It's not easy to think of a mind which is so primitive, but one should make the effort, I think. Well, this was the first consideration. The second consideration starts from the fact that, for instance, I am not sure that another man has a mind. I know it has a mind, but I cannot see, there is no probe, no direct probe for mind. I know that other people have a mind simply because they behave like I do. So it's just a parallel. I make a continuous parallel with myself. So the reactions they have to certain stimuli is similar to what my reaction. So, and why do they have that? They have receptors, and these receptors convey the information to other side of the nervous system, and this creates so-called qualia. Qualia means the mental images, the perceptive images, which are present in everybody. But they rise out of stimulation of different receptors that are reached by stimuli. And so there is this parallelism. You have physical phenomena from outside, and then you make mental phenomena inside. So I know that other people have mind simply by observing objectively that they have all the features necessary for the creation of qualia. Qualia means simply that they have a quality which not you can transmit to another man roughly, but I can never be sure that the kind of red, which I consider red of a special tonality, is exactly the same kind of red that the other person can see. So cannot be transferred precisely. They can simply be said that this is red, and this is blue, and so on. So if you start from this consideration, then you should also accept that whenever you have an organism that has the features which make you believe that another fellow man has a mind, then you should conclude that that organism may also have qualia. Qualia which are, of course, much more primitive, much simpler than yours, because yours is more developed. You see, if you use the human mind as a criterion for mind, you're stuck with man. You cannot go farther. If you look at the phylogeny, you have to look to a very basic feature of mind. And I consider one of the most basic features of mind that to create mental images out of, it's like the self which meets the non-self. Stimuli are outside us, non-self, and self reads them this way and creates these mental images. So if you accept this reasoning, then we forget about the presence of brain. I mean, we can go all the way down beyond the presence of nervous system, because even bacteria have receptors. Bacteria are plenty of receptors. So they may not have the nervous system that operates on these stimuli, but they have receptors. So I could still think that bacteria might have some very primitive form of mind. And so we go all the way to the very beginning of biological evolution. Then another consideration is that mind not only receives information from the outside, but also operates on this information. There is computing. It makes, it can extract more information from the first rough information to obtain meaning for the organism. The organism needs to know whether his environment is good or bad, and therefore adapt to it or just try to get rid and fight or fly, let's say. So this is another way to looking at the basic principle of mind. And learning is not only present in men, it's not only present in all animals, but there are papers which demonstrate that even bacteria are capable of learning. If Escherichia coli, which is in our intestine, is exposed to different set of environmental conditions, and they behave in a different way, whether they, according to the conditions, expressing genes which favor oxidative metabolism, if they, among the condition there is oxygen, or expressing genes which favor the anaerobic metabolism. So, and they can learn that to do one operation or the other operation. Of course, there is no nervous system whatsoever. There is a straight link between the various kinds of receptor and the gene expression system which they have. From this point of view, it's another addition that you may have very primitive mind, even in bacteria. Now, Of course, bacteria are just the beginning of biological entities. What, even they have a mind, but their mind, where did it come from? You can always ask this. And then you go backwards, and you go to the realm in which I think nobody would be ready to accept that there is a mind, because you go to the macromolecules, you go to the molecules, you go to the atoms, you go to the elementary particles. Well, I do not hope to convince you that you might have also a mind in the elementary particles, all the way to the elementary particle. But I've heard other people here that they believe so, and they certainly know much more elementary particles than I do, because I'm simply a neurobiologist. I can simply offer you two considerations. One consideration is just very simple. If we accept that at the present time there is physical bodies, physical processes, but also mental processes, then these must have come from the very beginning of the universe. And the universe, as we heard, was just the explosion, so-called explosion, at the Big Bang. And the Big Bang produced elementary particles. So mind, and not only matter, was present, or energy, or information, was present, first of all, in the adimensional entity which exploded, but then was potentially, and then was transferred to be in act and in the elementary particles. And from the elementary particles, you made all the entities. So you start making from nucleus, atoms, molecules, and so on and so forth. So this is one consideration, according to me, this simple reasoning that if you now have mind as well as matter, then everything must come from the very beginning. And otherwise, you have to explain why suddenly you have mind, or suddenly you have at the middle of phylogenesis. And you know, before the start of biological evolution, there is a much longer period in which there was an increase in complexity from elementary particles. If you go to the DNA, it's a tremendous increase in complexity. And there is no neo-Darwinism that can explain that. But that's the same process, the increase in complexity. Now the second consideration, and that's again a big jump, but if you accept that what I said before, that you have qualia, mental perception, out of stimuli that come from the outside, from the environment, you may ask yourself, what is the key event? According to me, the key event is when the stimulus reach the very beginning of the organism, which is the receptor, and modifies it. So this is an encounter which is crucial, because then it's followed by other processes. But that's a real encounter between non-self and self. And from this point of view, of course, all these non-biological entities continue to have, they've always had encounters with each other and between different levels and so on and so forth. So you can still think that perhaps that encounter is nothing really different, substantially different from the encounter with the receptor. Receptors came on later on. Initially, they were just encounter between themselves. And the encounters, I think, could be considered the engine of the universe. The universe has a duty. The duty of the universe is to evolve, to change, to become different from what it was. And you cannot become different if you do not encounter each other. So the encounter becomes a key event that to which there is certainly a physics involved, but also a mental, something mental. Because at that time, you know, there is, all these are non-differentiated entities. And non-differentiated means they cannot even perhaps talk about mental or material. They are just both. Like this happens frequently in biology. For instance, when you think of sleep, our sleep is very complex. And then if you go in phylogenesis, you find features of sleep which are very elementary and very undifferentiated. Even you cannot differentiate between waking and sleep, because there is no real wake, I mean, human type. You see, again, if you use your own parameters to go back to phylogenesis, then you cannot make any step backwards. So this is my general idea I had on mind and about evolution. I could add that if one of the main features of mind is that of solving problems, and we continuously solve our own problems whenever we encounter changes in our environment. And our environment, most of our environment is other men and other women, and that's a problem. If this is the main, one of the main functions is also creativity, solving a problem, in a way, is create something new. I consider it like you make a mosaic out of bits of information which you receive from the environment. But you know, this, I could continue for a long time, actually, to tell you that in sleep, it's easier to make this mosaic than in waking. There are experiments demonstrating that if you present a very simple mathematical problem to people in which there is some rules which that guy is supposed to follow, but there is a hidden rule which would allow the problem to be solved immediately, then people, if they sleep, they solve the problem 3 times faster than waking people. So that means, again, I was impressed by the figure of the iceberg that was shown before. And I want to mention also that the title of my talk was not the origin of consciousness. I always talk the origin of mind, because I think consciousness is just the little skin, which the little tip of the iceberg. The iceberg is supposed to be 8 times deep in the ocean. I think in the mind, the consciousness is only, and subconsciousness, unconscious. The unconscious is not only 8 times, but it's probably 8 billion times. It goes really all the way down to the very bottom of the beginning of life. So if you think, forgetting, if you think that mind is capable of solving problems and making this mosaic, well, and then if you think also that mind was present throughout biological evolution, then why not think that mind helped to make the right choice and the right variation? And by computing from all the information he had already acquired because the other thing is that what I believe is that the information throughout these 4 million years is probably present in the recent organism in some hidden part, and from time to time comes up if you really try and if you're lucky enough to find it. And that helps you, of course, to solve the problem. So that another paradigm in order to think of the mechanism of evolution, if you add the mind to it, then it becomes completely different from what neo-Darwinism tries to convince you. And I think that's a real sin of biology, to convince people that they are only made of pieces which came out of random events. I don't think so.